This morning, I'm continuing the message series called Learning Life the Hard Way. There's an easy way to do things, and there's a hard way to do things. And the Old Testament character Moses seems to always find the hard way. There's always a struggle, a tension, a conflict. And just when you think everything is going Moses' way, another difficulty makes life hard once again. Last week, we talked about Moses' critical decisions. Moses chooses to identify himself as a Hebrew, and he makes that loyalty known by killing an Egyptian who is beating a Hebrew. Now, Moses thinks he killed this Egyptian in secret, but he soon discovers that somebody saw him do it. And this somebody is spreading the story to everybody. And as soon as Moses finds out that Pharaoh is looking for him to kill him, Moses flees Egypt and he takes up residence in Midian. Moses begins a brand new life in Midian. He gets married and has a son. He works as a shepherd, taking care of his father-in-law's sheep. Moses spends the next 40 years living in tents and moving the sheep from place to place to find vegetation. It's a mundane life of just trying to survive day after day. Moses is now 80 years old. He will live to be 120. Moses spends his first 40 years in the luxurious palace of Egypt. He spends the next 40 years in the barren wilderness of Midian. Moses is now a forgotten man. He lives in obscurity. He lives in poverty. Moses figures that he'll simply live out his final days by looking after his family and the sheep until his body gives way and his days are no more. But then one day, something happens. God isn't finished with Moses. God has a new calling for Moses, a new assignment for a man who thinks his life is over. God is going to show up in Moses' mundane existence and challenge this disinterested shepherd to become a dynamic savior. If you have your Bible, I invite you to open it to the Old Testament book of Exodus, chapter 3. God is about to change Moses' career with a new calling in Exodus, chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. Now, Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. The home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now, the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Today, I want us to consider the theme, God has a calling. God has a calling for Moses. He has a calling for you, too. God has an assignment for Moses. He has an assignment for you, too. God hasn't given up on Moses. And God hasn't given up on you either. So today I want us to consider three characteristics of God's calling upon Moses' life. And you may notice that these same three characteristics are true about God's calling on your life as well. So let's look at them. Number one, a supernatural encounter. It begins like any other day. Verse 1 says that Moses is tending the sheep, leading them to a place of vegetation. But verse 2 indicates that Moses sees something unusual. He notices a bush, a thorny shrub. And there's nothing unique about this bush at first. It's on fire, but spontaneous combustion will burn a bush out in the wilderness. The thing that captures Moses' attention is that this bush is on fire, but it keeps burning. It's a burning bush. Verses 3 and 4 express that Moses pays attention to this burning bush, and he walks over to inspect it more closely. What if there were burning bushes in each of our lives, throughout our lives? What if the question is not, are there burning bushes, but will we turn aside and pay attention to those burning bushes? So what is a burning bush, spiritually speaking? A burning bush is a circumstance, an event that interrupts your daily life and captures your attention. It's something that takes you by surprise. It's something that stops you in your tracks. It's a moment when God brings something to your attention that you can't ignore. That burning bush experience may happen to you in your normal life. It did for Moses. He was keeping the sheep just like every other day. He was simply going about his normal daily routine. And you may be cleaning your house, reading a book, running an errand, or just simply working at your job. And something will grab your attention, and you just know this has to be a supernatural encounter. Chuck Swindoll put it this way, God may use an extraordinary event or circumstance to tap you on the shoulder in order to get your undivided attention. And it will be something that will intrude upon your daily life and say to you, wait a minute. Stop. Be still. I have something to say to you. And God may speak to you through a whisper, a feeling, a nudging, an idea that just won't go away. And the best places to hear God speak are when you're reading, praying, worshiping, singing, listening to the words of Scripture. An idea will pop into your head, and it will become a burning bush moment for you. God calls Moses by name from that bush in verse 4. Then God tells him in verse 5, "Don't come any closer, Moses. Take off your sandals, for the place where you're standing is holy ground." Sandals carry dirt, and it was a sign of respect to remove them when you enter a house or a place of worship. When people came into Pharaoh's presence, they would always take off their sandals, because failing to do so was a sign of disrespect. So Moses removes his shoes. This is a holy place. God is present. The proper response is reverence and respect. And Moses recognizes that God is about to interrupt his life through this supernatural encounter. How is God getting your attention these days? How is God interrupting your normal routine? Have you experienced something that you can call a supernatural encounter? Number two, a surprising entreaty. A surprising entreaty. God begins his conversation with Moses by identifying himself as Israel's God. "I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." He's also the God of those people in Egypt who are being mistreated and abused. Moses responds to God by turning away, not even looking. Perhaps Moses is ashamed by his failure. Maybe he thinks God has shown up to get even with him. Maybe God's presence reminds him of the life that he used to enjoy, but that life is gone by now. In any case, God proceeds to share his plan with Moses in verses 7 and 8. God says, "I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I'm concerned about their suffering. I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians." When Moses hears that God has come down to rescue the Israelites, he's probably thinking, "Yes, now it sounds like something is going to happen. Now I can finally put my past behind me. If somebody rescues the Israelites from the Egyptians, then I can stop blaming myself for failing to rescue them. I can finally put that part of my life behind me." But then comes the catch. God says to Moses in verse 10, "I want to send you to Pharaoh to bring my people out of Egypt." Wait a second. Moses is happy that God is going to do something, but he doesn't want to be the one to do it. I mean, Moses wants his people out of Egypt, but he doesn't want to get involved. Moses failed to see this one coming. I mean, he never thought it was possible for a bush to be on fire and not be burned up. He never expected or planned to be the one that would lead the Israelites out of Egypt, especially not now. This comes as a surprise beyond his wildest imagination. God chooses people to do his work. Sometimes God even chooses, calls, and uses the most unlikely of people to get his work done. God doesn't send a host of angels to rescue the Israelites out of Egypt. God doesn't perform miracles from heaven or suspend the laws of nature. No, God shows up in a burning bush to an 80-year-old shepherd. God chooses a shepherd who speaks the Egyptian language and who knows how the Egyptian government works. God chooses a person. How does God get his work done today? He works through people. He shows up in your life and calls you to do something for him. I want you to get involved in the children's ministry and teach the next generation about me. I want you to get involved in the youth ministry and help teenagers find God's path for them. I want you to work with senior adults and help meet the needs of those who are struggling. I want you to teach a Bible study class and help people learn the Bible. I want you to share your faith with your neighbor so that that person understands the Christian message. God has a calling for Moses. He has a calling for you, too. And notice that this entreaty that God gives to Moses is not a suggestion. It's not even an invitation. It's a calling. It's a command. God is sending Moses back to Egypt to rescue the Israelites. God's entreaty is a declaration. It's not really a choice. Number three, some shallow excuses. Now, after spending 40 years in the barren wilderness, you might anticipate that Moses would be overjoyed with God's calling. But he's not. In fact, he tries to weasel out of God's calling. Like us, he puts up a protest, hoping to persuade God to change his mind. So Moses says to God in verse 11, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? I mean, I have no leverage. I used to be a prince in Egypt, but now I'm just a shepherd. And Egyptians don't like shepherds." Moses feels inferior. He failed the last time. And now he doesn't want to take that risk of failing again. God answers Moses in verse 12, "I will be with you. You don't have to do this alone. I'll go with you." It doesn't matter how insignificant Moses is. It matters how significant God is. It's not little nobody Moses challenging the powerful Pharaoh. No, it's little nobody Moses and big somebody God together saying to Pharaoh, "Let my people go." When God calls you to do something, he promises to be with you. He'll be with you as you teach that Bible study class. He'll be with you as you minister to people at the Agape House. He'll be with you as you greet our guest on Sunday morning. He'll be with you when you visit people in the hospital and pray for them. If God is calling you to do something for him, he promises that he's going to be with you and he'll help you do it. Yet there are times when all of us make excuses for not doing what we know God wants us to do. The good news for Moses is that God isn't about to take no for an answer. But yet imagine with me for just a moment, if God responded to all of Moses' excuses by saying, "No problem, Moses. I'll just find somebody else. You just stay right here, watch over the sheep, and live in the desert for the rest of your life. Moses would have missed out on the greatest moments of his life. He would have missed being used by God to rescue an entire nation. He would have missed God's calling on his life. A few years ago, I had two separate gentlemen come up to me and say, I think I missed God's calling for my life in my early years. I think God was calling me to be a pastor, but I chose a different career. And one man became quite successful working for a large corporation. The other man became a successful lawyer. But as both of these men either retired or neared the end of their working career, they said, I believe that God is calling me to be ordained. I feel in my spirit that God is still calling me. And I had the privilege of leading both men through an ordination ceremony. Today, both of those men are preaching in a church on Sunday morning. One is preaching in a church in Kentucky and has been doing so for the past several years. The other is preaching in a church just outside of Ocala, and he helped rebuild this church and restart this church after COVID caused the church to temporarily shut down. God is using both of those men today in his service. It's not too late. Even if you think you've been out in the wilderness for the past 40 years, it's not too late. God is still calling you. God can still use you. God still has a plan for you. At every age and stage of life, God has a mission, a calling for you. Your job is to pay attention to the burning bush, to the whisper of God's Spirit, to that nudging inside your heart. And when God says to you, go, I'm sending you, your best response is to say, God, here I am. I'm ready to go. God has a calling on your life too. How are you responding to God's calling? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this story of Moses. Father, there are just so many lessons that come out of this story. Father, your gifts and your callings, they don't go away. Even if we ignore them, you're still calling. It's not too late. You can still use us in a big way. And Father, Moses, he responds like most of us would. He has all kinds of excuses as to why he's not the right one. But God, you chose him. And because you chose him, he is the right one. And you are going to be with him, and you're going to help him and guide him every step of the way, just like you do for us today. So, Father, it's my prayer for all of us that we would look inside and ask the question, what is God calling me to do? Where can God use me today to be effective for him? Father, thank you that you call us all. You have a plan. You have a purpose for all of us. And Father, may all of us surrender to your calling so that we can be used by you too. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.